Welcome to Enki Magic 150. For the third time, my guest is Dutch Grandmaster Jan Werle. Hello, Jan.
Hello, Christian.
Many thanks that you joined me again. Did you come to Hamburg especially for the 150th anniversary Enki Magic show, or did you have also other projects?
Definitely, I was come for your show, of course. Congratulations with your jubilee. And furthermore, I'm also recording my own DVD about the Catalan.
And you are also, your other DVDs on Bishop B5 repertoires against the Sicilian also have just appeared. And of course, they are very interesting. And also Sicilian players should get them to know how to deal with your approach.
Yeah, indeed. It's going very well, selling like hotcakes. And games, there are games on the highest level. So Caruana played recently a game against Dubov during Wijk aan Zee, and with a novelty for my DVD. Oh. Well, probably he prepared them himself, but anyway, it's a line which is in progress.
And which makes sense, of course, well, has strategic sense. In the Sicilian, often the bishop F1 can develop into slightly problem piece. The pawn on E4 is also in a light square, and if you play bishop B5, you can solve the problem in a way.
Yeah, there's some new ideas indeed in this DVD. Yeah.
And now you are dealing with a Catalan from White's
perspective. Yeah.
Okay, so for the moment you are a white man in a way.
Kind of. Yeah.
And of course you also beat Alexey Shirov, who was my guest in the first Enki Magic show, and also several times further. So this really connects very well from the first show to the 150th, and it also of course proves again that the chess world is a very small world. But congratulations on beating such a strong player in the German Bundesliga. And yeah, if you have time, of course we should also have a short look at this game.
Thank you.
Okay, but let's start also with the Bundesliga. Jean-Michel Sprenger against Sergei Fedorchuk. Yeah, these rook endings, they are always drawn, but when you are over the board against these super strong players, then you tend to get doubts on it, yeah? Why to move and draw? But of course, Sprenger didn't know that. And had he known, he would have found, I guess, but otherwise over the board, of course, you could also assume that White's counterplay is too slow and you should be losing anyway.
Yeah, well, I think you have to give up your rook, and then in this rook against pawn endings, you should cut off the kings, the black king. So I guess king d4 might be a good move.
Very good.
Then f4, yeah.
Very rook good, very f1. Good. Very good, very good.
To take, and then f4.
Yeah, and now, right.
The king comes.
And now the king is in the body check, borrowed from ice hockey, the term now. Yeah. And this is a big moment why king d4 had to be played. And now it is relatively clear that it is a draw. Well done. Okay, I have two more questions, of course. Why is king d4 is the only move to draw? Why is f4 a mistake?
Why is f4 a mistake? Rook a4.
Yeah, the typical way. Yeah, it's also this is a reason why it makes sense to study rook against pawn. A lot of these motifs also then crop up in certain kind of rook endings.
Yeah, the white king can go around the f pawn by king f3 and king g4. But I guess he's too late and he doesn't cut off the white king anymore. The black king anymore, sorry.
Yeah.
So what I mean is king takes a1.
Yeah, but here, yeah.
King g4, king b2, and you don't cut off this king, and white is too late. Should be. So.
Or
should it's not so easy, eh?
Or should we have taken here with the rock? This looks a bit.
Yeah, well, king c4 and then rook e1 check. So king e5, king c5, f6, rook e1 will win.
We should have taken here again with the rook.
Yeah.
This is quite, he played rook a4 and nevertheless moved the rook because now white can't play king d4. Mm-hmm. If white could play king d4 now, it would be a draw. But.
Yeah, this is true. Yeah.
That's a fascinating example for this typical body check phenomenon. Okay, and in the game, Sprenger played king e4, but we, of course, already know why it doesn't work. Then this, this, and then the game. Oh, yeah, of course, if the king takes, then f4 would be a draw. Again, the rook has to take, and we have similar scenario. Yeah, and then black's body check decides the issue in typical fashion in black's favor.
Yeah, king e6.
And Sprenger resigned. Okay, next also from the Bundesliga, next from Hillerød, excuse me, from Brøndum Madsen, not from the Bundesliga, of course. White to move and draw. All rook endings are drawn after all.
That's what's said, but probably there are a lot of exceptions to this rule.
As, yeah, only those rook endings you lose yourself on your board, they are not drawn.
Yeah. So the question is...
White to move and draw.
White to move and draw.
Yeah, okay, but in a way it doesn't matter too much anyway, so only it doesn't matter. Even if white would be losing, the best try would be in all cases, of course. Active or passive?
Yeah, active, huh? King e5.
Only move, yeah. Only move to draw. This is also what Brøndum played. King takes c3 is, of course, is losing. Not of course, but it's losing.
End. Yeah, two pawns down, and the h pawn will walk. Yeah.
So this indeed is right, but here, Brøndum made a mistake. Mm-hmm. A typical mistake, by the way. This is also in a way why I show it. Dr. Tara's guideline that the rook belongs behind the passed pawn is a very, very basically good guideline. No matter if it's friendly or enemy, but it is also the guideline, I think the endgame guideline, which leads to the most mistakes in human games. Mm-hmm. So rook g6 check is a losing mistake by Brøndum, but probably he just saw that, okay, he cuts off the king and he puts the rook. He saw that the rook here has many good jobs, mm-hmm. but what did he miss? How did Michael Ole Madsen answer?
I guess d4.
Yeah, and then... Brøndum resigned.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, we come to the main reason why I chose the example is that the guideline that the rook belongs behind the passed pawn is very good, but you should never follow it automatically, and is one of the guidelines which leads to the most mistakes in human games. Some players just see they can move behind it, they move behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what... You already know that it's a draw, so it's a bit how to do it. In a way, it also doesn't matter. It's in both natural move. F6 draws, king e6 draws. Let me take this one. Yeah, and white is just in time with the counterplay. But here comes a slightly precarious moment again.
Yeah. Would it be useful to play first king d7 and then king e7? Are there some checks with king f6, rook g6, some drawing ideas?
Uh-huh. But then I have... king, for example, king e7 is losing. Just one... Then I already see you are then black is winning. Yeah. The pawns.
Yeah, they are too strong.
Decide the day. So here we need a special idea. But in a way, it's easier. Your idea, king f6, looks a bit like magic in endgame magic. But king f6.
Yeah, the idea is to play rook g6 check, king rook g7, and threaten a mate if he goes to h8 with rook g5.
I didn't look at that one.
But maybe you can play h3,
mm-hmm.
after rook g6, king h5, you can escape to h4.
Yeah, and if you play rook h1...
Then king h5. Okay. The king becomes very active, it quickly goes to e3.
Yeah, so in a way I don't know, but it's a bit easier in a way here. Your variation would be magic anyway. It's a bit easier to draw this. You can more or less draw directly.
Mm-hmm.
There is no need for such deep magic.
King d7 maybe? And the other tries king d5, king e4.
Uh-huh. Okay. Interesting. I didn't check those tries. They are fantastically, but it's a bit the computer and so on. It is a bit more direct in a way, I think, what the computer gives. But it might also be slightly paradoxical.
Well, rook c1. I throw in the towel, I don't know.
Rook c1.
Uh-huh. That makes sense, yeah.
To just play. So with your tries, I don't know. They are also fascinating, but this just... has the threat rook takes c2.
Yeah, it's quite easy actually.
And it's easier than your suggestions. And if black plays king g7, we can give check again, and then black cannot change matches. Okay. Good. Then, yeah, and here also. Wrong would be king f6 due to d4, king e7, d3, king takes c2.
Yeah, the pawns are too fast.
And black is winning. Yeah. Yeah. And basically that's the end of the story. Okay, now again from the Bundesliga, Vladimir Malachov gegen Zoltan Olmoshi, white to move and win. Okay.
Knight takes g5?
Yeah, first move is, I just had to start at some moment, of course. Yeah, if I take, then it's clear that you're gonna win. Yeah, and then you can win as you like. Here you could also win like this, and then your king is in the inside of the large winning zone, but this is just for educational purposes, and it's deep inside the winning zone, and I always like to present the winning zone no matter how how relevant the variation is. But
yeah, the king is approaching and you threaten mate.
The winning zone is even larger, yeah. So mm-hmm. it's easy. Of course, you could also win here without the winning zones, and it would also be quicker to win like this. And to keep the g pawn, which also prevents the stalemate defense.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So in a way, the other would be bad technique, but when you know the winning zones, it wouldn't matter. But I just always like it for didactical purposes in any positions where it makes some sort of sense to go to the winning zones and to show them, because I like these graphical rules so much.
Yeah, it's nice indeed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some humans like these graphics more, others like more numbers and more calculation, more things. So good about chess is that both of these approaches have some meaning in the game.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but of course we wouldn't be looking at this example if that would have been the end of the story.
It would be too easy, yeah.
Of course, Olmoshi took the pawn. And here, of course, how do you continue? What was your choice? Your preference?
First fault might be knight h3, knight f4. Isn't that very easy to win this way?
Yeah, so you I see that you want to win by using Suk Svang, and you are, of course, absolutely right. And Vladimir Malachov did the same. And I think most humans would go for this Suk Svang kind of winning approach.
Yeah, I'm too lazy to calculate knight f7, knight h6. So, yeah. But it might also very well. Oh, yeah, it might win. Yeah. It is winning. Because knight goes to f5 and g3. And,
Yeah, and it also wins.
Yeah,
but I agree with you. Malachov did the same, and I think most humans would choose some sort of Suk Svang win. Knight e3 is also okay. Just he played this. It doesn't matter. No. Suk Svang. Black has to make one important concession. But what now? That's another. We have the same question again, I think. Sort of. What is the word of win? You can win many ways, but what is the word of choice?
Sure. Well, not knight f5, f3, knight h6, f2, knight f5. Because black promotes to a knight on f1.
But that was a game. Yeah, you're absolutely right, but that was a game. Here, Malachov shows it. I don't know. These super strong players sometimes have a feeling for aesthetics. And I think he shows this deliberately due to this knight promotion feature, I think.
Yeah. Or maybe the pawn is just deciding the game.
It wins, of course. Malachov played it. He's 2,600. He's very strong. Might be even. And here in this position, Zoltan Olmeshi resigned. I think he shows it due to this one reason, due to this aesthetic pleasure of a knight promotion. Okay, so, but you said you wouldn't go here, so what? So, but this wins, and this was the game. What would you prefer? The Verle win?
Knight f3.
I have to play king e3 or resign. Okay, I play this.
Yeah, knight h2.
Yeah. This is the Verle win.
Yeah, it's an easy win.
Yeah, I agree. And I think Malachov deliberately chose the other variation, allowing his Olmeshi to promote to a knight. The super strong players have, most of them have also a special feeling of the chess beauty and aesthetics. And if allowing and it's clear, then they will go for the beauty if it's safe.
Yeah, it pops up in the eye and they start calculating the lines and they will go for it if it works.
Yeah, and here, of course, it does. Okay, yeah, then let's go ahead. This was announced on the website, I think, and we must look at it, of course. Verle against Erasmus Gehrig. Here first, your opponent Erasmus Gehrig played king g7, and this is a mistake, which you exploited forcefully and beautifully by opening up the gates of black's non-existing fortress. Yeah, if he takes, then you are just in command. You open up your king road if he played king f8, but it's also not. After king g8, by the way, you could have won by check this. This and Suk Svang. Typical stuff. One must always be careful when advancing such a pawn to the seventh rank. In many cases, it would be a mistake, of course, if the king had no hiding place. So then it's a mistake often committed. But here, of course, you can invade with your king and eat up the f7 pawn in the end.
Yeah, this is winning.
So he went to e8, but of course, here you can now make a trade and he resigned because your rook dominates everybody and your king is free to do the rest. Okay, but he could have defended. But over the board, of course. Rook endings are always drawn, but over the board.
It's not so easy over the board now, that's true, but...
You don't have a computer at hand.
Yeah, but you should play actively here and...
For some check, then some stopping of the things. And then f6 to be more active. And according to the computer, this would draw. Yeah, here he would just be in time to find a hiding place. And then b7 would not be so good.
Yeah. Yeah, this is not winning.
No, and even b7 is it's not good because now the rook on b8 is a very stupid man. Really stupid. Yeah.
Yeah, indeed, this f6 plan was... I remember this is a very good move. And
it draws according to the computer.
It forces the draw, yeah.
But okay, I don't want to criticize Erasmus Gehrig. Over the board, still move 52, running short of time, defending against a strong Dutch grandmaster who makes pressure, and
thank you.
It's not so easy to withstand that. Then, your game against Sipke Ernst from the Bundesliga 2019, your countryman who plays for my club, the Hamburger SK, and who has been my guest in Endgame Magic in January, which can still be viewed in the Endgame Magic archives in the chess-based video portal. And he has also made a DVD, which will... Yeah, the Dutch are very active always.
Yes, we have a name. But... Now, he was kind of outplaying me in this game, and he's a strong player, and...
Rook 8, and you were in deep trouble.
Deep trouble.
Here, again, in a way, also the same motive, this rook with the pawn. This was what I liked about these games. They have some sort of similar motives in that respect.
Yeah, so I went for the last straw.
All right, here... Here you made a mistake, but I don't want to criticize you. You were short of time, probably, it was in move 59, yeah?
Yeah. I just wanted to trick him, because I think the position is hopeless for
black. In all cases?
Yeah.
Okay, I haven't checked that again with the engine. Maybe, yeah. But the engine thinks you should play like this. And then, I should have checked it maybe.
But I think this is a very difficult position to defend. And
without the endgame table bases at your hands, definitely. And I didn't check again. I don't know. Yeah, I have to sit on the fence. It might be winning or it might be a draw, but it's the best computer. Okay, but you played definitely losers, so from in the computer's eyes. But
I didn't like that my king can't approach here to the deep pawn. It's shut out. And this knight d4's check is coming, so...
This move has a metaphysical touch to it. I see your point.
Mm.
Your move is a human natural move. So, okay. Shall I give a full question mark or only a dubious?
I'll give it two.
I give it a full question mark because it loses. And maybe you underestimated the answer or... Because now you are standing in the... On b5, you are standing in a better position to the knight than now. Oh. Or did you...
I can't recall exactly anymore.
Oh, okay. No, it's move 6d, so it's always a bit...
This time pressure is
annoying, of course. Mm-hmm. And certainly king b5 is not a time trouble move. This is a move you need time to... Here... To play king b5 here, you need time to convince yourself to do it, I think. Yeah? It's not a time trouble move, I think, in my opinion, at least for me.
I don't know. Okay, it's hard to say something about it.
These psychological questions are always a bit... I understand.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but the problem is that now... Here he could also have taken this with win. So, but you see that your king b5 is better than this any in all cases anyway.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, you're right.
Because here, this can't be better than the...
No, definitely not. No.
So I gave a full question mark.
Yeah.
Okay, he took the knight. Okay. Excuse me. Check. King a3. He took the knight. King b2. Yeah, here he could also have played knight b4. And again, we have some similar. Your game is a bit. We have some similarities, but your games tend to feature similar motives. Yeah, like this is what I select. Shows this selection of examples.
Yeah, there's again a nice promotion in these. Yeah, you're right.
But you, I think, agree with me now that the full question mark is justified.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
This must be the other might be losing. This must be losing.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Okay, he played knight f4. Check, but here, yeah, and now it was his time to. Here he should play king f3. He played king d4, but rook d7, check, king. Ah, yeah, and here a draw was agreed, correct?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Because I can take on d3 if he goes to e4, and I can promote. And after knight d3, I could take on d3.
Yeah. That's here.
I'm
queen.
I hope that is right.
Knight d3. You take.
Yeah, I take, and a rook takes g3.
Yeah. And this is a double attack against the rook and the a pawn, and.
Yeah.
This is I can attack it. I can make one last trick, but then you have probably many moves. One of them is rook a3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and of course, trying these tricks against a strong grandmaster is not worth it, so a draw was agreed.
Yeah, I was very lucky here. He should have won, but.
But I, in a way, I liked it. It had some connection to the other examples, knight promotion and so on. One is missing, of course. Here he should play king f3. Rook f7, king g2, you promote to a knight. Again, yeah?
Yes. Sure.
But still now a4 or rook c5, it should both be. a4 or rook c5 should both be winning. a4, rook a7, and rook c4, or rook c5, knight takes. And g4. At least this is what the computer gives. Yeah, but of course we also have to, we must look at your fantastic performance. Alexey had been my guest in the first Endgame Magic show. It was really a great honor to have him here. It was. It can still be viewed in the Endgame Magic archives. It's one of the most popular Endgame Magic shows ever. And he has been my guest several times later. Also, I had been his second in the Munich tournament at the beginning of the 19th, which was great. He played 2 years together with me in the Hamburger SK Bundesliga team. In the first season, he made on the second board 9.5 out of 10. This was not such a bad result, or
not at all. The strongest league of Europe. So yeah, this is amazing.
Yeah, he was still on the back then. Of course, he was still on the rise towards the world top 10. Yeah. But yeah, okay. So it's great that you played against him and you won. That is, of course, definitely worth having a look.
That's nice, thank you.
I should. Okay. We can. Okay, I know that this position is not an end game and it could be discussed, but I think for this show and UFF, you here in the 150 in the first show, it doesn't matter too much. We don't want to define. What an endgame is and what is not, we have to look at it.
Yes, sure.
But I see that it's not a real endgame like the other. But okay, here you prepared. This is you prepared. Yeah, and this is quite poisonous.
This is a very popular line these days. And Erwin Lamy played it also recently. AC Penko in Gibraltar and won against the Italian Grandmaster Basso. And the idea is that, okay, you attack b7, so queen b6 is coming. Now I play immediately Knight e5, and it's hard for Black to place his bishop on, for example, h5. It happened in the game, but ideas White takes on d5, and after c takes d5, you give a check on b5. That's actually the main idea.
Bishop b.
Yeah, bishop b5. So that's why the Black players, they can't really take back with the c pawn, and they're limited in their choice.
And okay, yeah, great. If I play knight e7, it's clear. If I play knight c. You just...
Yeah, White is not in a hurry even, so he could also just play, let's say, knight c3, bishop d2, rook c1.
Ah, okay.
And yeah, the bishop on h5 is not doing much.
Okay. So, Alexey, this is, I guess, all theory and...
Yes.
Yeah, and nowadays, it's... Yeah, okay. So, he exchanged when, end game, but it's more like a queenless middle game. I think the way you played it and so on more looks like a queenless middle game.
Yeah, it's a middle game. Yes, and an interesting moment arises after the 11th move, f6.
Okay, so after the move,
so plays e4 knight before, and yeah, so most logical move is bishop g6, but he played f6.
Yeah, this is also what my question was. Why did f6 looks a bit odd to me? Bishop g6 looks more logical, and then, well, yeah, you can play it, of course, but it's only very slight.
Yeah, typical for this kind of position, slight advantage. At some point, I'll grab that bishop and claim that I have a tiny advantage because of the bishop pair. But, okay, of course, Shirov is a very creative player, and after the game, he also said, well, I wanted to complicate matters. And
so am I allowed to give f6 a dubious mark, or is this going too far?
According to the computers, and objectively speaking, maybe yes, but during a normal game.
Okay, then I'll do it just to keep the convention of my show in a way. Of course, but it had some advantages because I guess it was a surprise for you.
It was definitely a surprise, and his idea is, okay, he takes on e5, and d takes e5, knight d7.
This is a deep move. King e2. Maybe this king e2 was a surprise for him, or?
I think so. Now, we're out of book, both, but this was just a game. Yeah, he has two ideas, knight c5 and knight e5, and on both the moves, king e2 is useful.
So go to the cap of distance to the knight e5. So, so some endgame features it has, in a way.
Agree. Yeah.
Now the computer thinks that the next move is a big mistake. So am I allowed to give a question mark, or...
Cool. Well, I think it's a logical move, knight c5.
Then I will downgrade it, but I have to do something here. The computer claims that he should never... You have brought your king to position, but a pawn is a pawn, after all, also.
But he takes the pawn on e4. Here I would play bishop h3, and I think that I have a pleasant position.
Yeah, I, of course, don't disagree. But for some reason, the computer thinks that knight takes e5 is called for. King f. What can I do? King f7 or.
I think you should defend the pawn on e6, so play king f7. And then white goes king bishop e3. But this looks like a very pleasant position because the knights don't coordinate. At least I don't think that he's going to play knight d3. And I will play at some point f4.
With Shirov, you never know.
That makes sense, yeah. But.
Okay, I basically in a way, but okay, I agree with you, of course. I'm also a fan of the bishop pair, but I think in some objective, this would limit the damage to Black's position, nevertheless, in a way, probably. But still, But I guess knight c5 goes too far, in a way. Okay, you also played bishop e3.
But yeah, it's for us mortals very hard to foresee all the consequences, and the computer can, of course.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This makes sense, this whole line, because after knight takes e4, Shirov wants to play knight d5 and creates the square for his other knight, and then he's going to exchange the bishop.
Yeah, but your initiative feels stronger than in the other position, at least to me.
Yeah, because I think he missed knight takes e3, f takes e3.
Okay, if now knight takes e3, he calculated king.
I guess he probably king e3, and then this. He has enough counterplay after knight g5 and bishop c5 check.
Bishop somewhere, and then bishop c5 check. Yeah, this of course is a different story. He has opposite colored bishops, and yeah, this is a different story. I agree with you. This of course, these are the points why it's good to have you here and to ask the points directly. The points the computer can't give me in a way. Of course is deep.
Yeah.
This I will give a double exclam. Shirov missed it. You saw it. It's a bit like these Carlsen So position where Magnus played knight c4, allowing his structure to be blown away against Wesley So, the endgame, which was second in the vote of the endgame of the year 2019 on the Chessbiz website. There also Magnus. And here, of course, you have... Oh, this is fantastic. You could compete. You have more. You can compete. You have more.
During the game, I didn't even realize that I have so many dull pawns. But now that you color it, it becomes clear.
Fantastic. I, of course, also missed it. Fantastic. The problem, of course, is... Endgame of the year 2020. A slight problem is, of course, that this is not really an endgame. So I cannot promise you anything. But and this also didn't appear. If this had appeared on the board, it would also be a bit different, you know. But the Carlsen So appeared on the board and then it went on. But here it's a bit more hidden. But it's very and if now knight g5 is similar ideas.
I thought I haven't checked it with the computer, but I think I play bishop g4 and then next. At a suitable moment, I play h4.
And now I have no bishop. Yeah, you guess it. Okay. Very interesting. This, of course, I also didn't check with the computer. but it's a really, I of course, like, the good about chess, and what I like is the rules and the guidelines, they are nice, but they are not what makes chess fascinating. You don't go each morning to the mirror and then learn the golden guidelines of the endgame by heart and repeat them and know them. This is not the secret. This is not what fascinates most humans, I think. What fascinates the humans is the exceptions to the guidelines. Yeah? Or?
Yes, indeed. And it gives me a lot of practical, dynamical chances, this h5 pawn, for example, because g7 is now a weakness. If I play rook g1, he finds it very hard to develop his bishop.
I also think that you have a very strong feeling for these dynamics of the game. One shouldn't give you these dynamical positions. Yeah? One should dry you a bit out. This would be better against you, I think. To give you these dynamical chances is dangerous.
I don't know.
Who knows?
But I was happy when after f6 I realized g takes h5, the pawn is standing well there, and I get these chances.
Bishop g6 in a way looks, this is why I gave f6 a dubious sign. Yes, it gives you these very dangerous dynamical chances. Okay, good. Okay, knight c4, knight c5, and here, of course, maybe also here you, of course, a very good feeling for the dynamics again. B4,
Of course, I would like to keep my bishop on e3.
In a way, it looks like Shirov is white, and so this fire on board looks more like Shirov is playing with white. Or
thank you. He's a fantastic player, so I'm happy to you make this comparison.
Yeah, and he was number 3 of the world, but it's some time ago, of course. But these kind of players you don't beat every day, I think. And still, he's a strong grandmaster. So it's a good... achievement.
Thank you.
Here also you had a choice. Knight b6 is also very strong according to the computer, but
I spent a lot of time here and I thought about knight b6 indeed, and rook a5.
Yeah.
But after rook d8, rook a7.
Why didn't you play knight b6, by the way?
Yeah, I had to make a choice between these two moves. Both looked promising. And these are the most difficult choices in chess, I think. Especially when you have a winning position. There are two good options. Which one do you choose?
The computer also likes this a lot. But
yeah. And the advantage was also of knight b6 that he can't go back to d5.
Mm.
Of course, it's a strong square. I can just take the knight and I can keep my bishop again on e3. But you're right, knight c2.
That was
the reason that I didn't play at knight c2.
Mm.
This is over.
The computer, I think, thinks that knight b6 in its world is even slightly better, but okay. I don't give any signs here to nothing, of course.
No, and this now arises a very interesting position, because after knight d5, this probably was also Shirov's first choice.
Yeah.
He didn't play it, but...
But he should have played it.
The question is, can I take on c5, or can't I?
Who takes on c5?
Yeah, with the bishop.
Ah, yeah. This is also what the computer wants.
Yeah, the knight f4 check. And can I lock in the knight on h3?
The computer thinks you can't.
Yeah, and I think the computer is right.
In these kind of questions, I also usually think the computer is right. When the computer is wrong, it must be extremely deep, and opening analysis can happen, of course, and in endgames connected to certain kind of fortresses or certain kind of very deep questions, the computer could also be wrong. But in these kind of questions, the computer should be right. So here, again, I unfortunately have to follow the computer.
But you know, can I show you one more line of the knight d5, bishop c5, knight f4 check.
Of course.
To show you how difficult and how deep it is.
Okay.
Because king e3. Yes, and here f4. And my idea is to play rook f1 and rook f3.
And then knight g1 and rook g3 and I'm toast.
So it's very understandable that Shirov didn't go for this. It looks so extremely dangerous.
Mm-hmm. And how do I solve
Apparently you don't lose the knight because black can take on c5, play short castling, and rook f5.
And then
he's just in time.
And then my knight on the rim is still there.
It's still there, yeah, but it's a difficult choice for him to make. And it was not necessary for me to play king e3.
The computer wants to play, the computer wants to go here, but yeah. This is a computer line.
Now I take on f8.
Yes.
Rook takes, knight d6 check.
Yes.
And f4. And the knight should go to f7. Aha, he plays b6. Okay, I play rook a6, rook a1, I think.
Is this right? I attack.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, and he takes back with the rook, and then he defends a7, but I can play rook takes b6. So knight f7, rook f7, rook fa1.
Okay, one moment. If I take the king, you're double, and then it's a bit... So I take the rook, you go here.
Yeah, king f8. And rook takes b6. Looks better for white.
Yeah. But here, okay, so it's, yeah.
Have the more active rook to take back.
Yeah, I see your point. So, let's see.
No, in practical game, it's very hard to defend.
Yeah, you're
for black.
Your pawns e5, h5. They are nice fence against my my king.
E6 can become weak.
Yeah, but still, somehow can't I do it away a bit? Can't I be a bit more? If I take the king, you double. I play rook d8. You take. I go to the right square.
Is there a right square?
Hopefully.
Rook e7.
I go to the right square. You named it. Excuse me. All rook endings
A6,
are...
A6, maybe?
All rook endings are drawn, you don't lose. Yeah, so...
A6, yeah.
I didn't give your move any kind of marks. I guess this position, if the computer defends, it should be defendable as all rook endings we have already seen in the show, but we have already seen in the show that over the board in human games, you name it.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't give you any, but I should upgrade this for objective reasons, and maybe here I also want to upgrade this in a way, but because if you take the other pawn, it looks so ugly, but who knows. But okay, this is very difficult.
Very difficult, yeah.
For black to defend. Mm-hmm. It should be a draw, but I don't want to prove my claim over the board. I only at home with my computer.
Yeah, well, still, I had was on plus something, I think, but...
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Not the big advantage, but pleasant advantage. Yeah.
Of course, two results, pleasant, you yeah. press, and if black finds, then probably. So, knight d5 should be played here. This already looks a bit, what he played here, and rook d8, this looks a bit desperate to me in a... In a way.
Yeah, but again, what else? If he plays bishop e7 and I'll give a check.
Computer wants to go knight b3.
Aha. I didn't look at this. But actually here I was already, we were in a time scramble.
Mm-hmm. Rook a2. Yeah, but yeah, it's also already, it's of course already good for you just to... This maybe limits the damage
A bit. Change the bishops, yeah.
Or okay, maybe it doesn't work and you...
But it's against a high price.
Yeah, but you have a point. But you, of course, have a point. The computer just claims that this is more tenacious in a way. Yeah, and probably it is. It's a bit... Because in the game, it already gets very... But he was probably already short of time.
Yeah, we both were. Well, yeah, still 20 moves to make.
Yeah. Yeah, but here.
Yeah, it's, I think, less than 5 minutes on the clock, but I think this was the last difficult move I had to make. And what black can't do much against
b4. Maybe rook f7 or...
Mm-hmm. B4?
What did the computer intend then? E5 or?
But can you rook G4, for example?
Okay, rook takes D6, yeah, and...
Yeah, I don't believe that.
Close eyes and go here. Yeah.
B takes C5 must be winning.
Yeah. Yes. But I have three pawns.
Congratulations.
Thank you. But it is winning, but it might be, of course, these fights can then last forever. Even the pawnless two bishops against knights always win, but in the worst case, more than 60 move to mate. So these fights can last until you really have out fox smarter than whatever the knight. This can take long, long time.
Yeah.
But it's not pleasant, I see.
I think it's close to winning.
It's more like a nightmare. But yeah. It might be I don't give any signs anymore. So the game was this. B4, you took. But now your d pawn is just... Yeah. Your d pawn is just too strong. You have the d pawn and the bishops and the both knights on the rim.
Yeah, it's not so difficult anymore. I could grab the exchange with bishop g5, and all the moves were quite easy, like h6 or g3. And yeah.
Many thanks, Jan, for joining me again in the anniversary show, 100, number 150.
Yeah, thank you that I could be your guest during this nice broadcast.
Yeah, it all the way also connected to Endgame Magic 1, because on the last weekend you won against Alexei Shirov, who was my guest in the first show. And this is very, very pleasant and nice, of course. And in a way, it also proves how small the chess world really is. Okay, so let's see what happens, what will happen in the 200th show or whatever. We will see. Marijn van Delft has ja already made 400 Games of the Week shows and he does it every week. So for me, he is unovertakable. he has already such a large lead and he does it every week.
Okay, yeah, that's, yeah, respect.
Yeah, I'm Marijn van Delft. Yeah, also the Dutch are very active. Robert Riss has his show. They have a good soccer team. They sometimes beat Germany. They are very strong in chess and so.
I see. Yeah.
Okay. So many thanks to the viewers and have a nice evening.
Goodbye.